Hi, everybody. You know, in my life, I've been blessed to have been able to meet with people in other professions that I'd not known before, and they allowed me to appreciate their talents. Well, our guest today is such a person. He is one of the most respected musical conductors in the world, in film and also in television productions as well. He performs film and classical music in concert halls and classical music in recordings as well. In fact, I think he has probably been to every major city that's had a symphony in the world over the years. This marks Richard Kaufman's 31st season as principal pops conductor of Orange County's Pacific Symphony, and he's added the title laureate. It's his 18th season with the Chicago Symphony Orchestra Concert Series, and he holds the permanent title of Pops Conductor Laureate with the Dallas Symphony. It is a pleasure today for me to talk to one of my best friends, Richard Kaufman.
How you doing, Ross?
Doing great and glad to have you on.
Thank you. You sound like a combination of my father and my agent.
What a wonderful career you've had.
I've been blessed. I look back and I think about, you know, the opportunity to work with people and just meet them and all. And I grew up a fan. I mean, I grew up a fan of music and of baseball. You know, I can't, you know, count the number of times that I've, you know, listened to you and all that, you know, with the broadcasting and, you know, the idea that I, you know, I got to meet you in person, and the idea that we're so close as friends now is I kind of shake my head and say, I wonder how that happened. You know, but I do that a lot because I've been very, very fortunate to work with a lot of wonderful people. I've had opportunities, many of which I'm sure I didn't deserve, but I love music. And I think especially today, in a world that's very, very challenging and very difficult and dark, that music is an oasis for a lot of people. And for me to be able to be part of that and use that maybe to brighten people's lives. I sound like, that sounds like a Miss America speech. But,
Burt but, Parks.
which I'll never win that contest. But I really am so fortunate. It's so great to talk with you. And, you know, Gail and I just love you and Lynn. And anyway.
Hey, folks, here's all you need to know about Richard Kaufman. Are you familiar with the name John Williams? Yeah. John Williams has composed and conducted some of the most popular and recognizable film scores in history. John has won 25 Grammy Awards, 5 Academy Awards, and his 52 Academy Award nominations are second behind only Walt Disney. Mm-hmm. He's considered one of the greatest composers in the history of cinema. In fact, his Star Wars has been selected as the best film score of all time. John Williams's other musical hits include Jaws, E.T., Schindler's List, Saving Private Ryan, and the Jurassic Park, Harry Potter, and Indiana Jones films. So you're saying, well, how does John Williams figure into Richard Kaufman's career? Here's how. Anytime John cannot fulfill a concert engagement, he tells his staff, call Richard and see if he is available.
Ross, that's partly true. That's not always true, but I've been very fortunate a few times that I've been able to do that. Once to replace John when he wasn't feeling well with the Boston Pops, but especially to do concerts where he decides to do the second half of the concert and I've done the first half. So truth in advertising, it's happened a few times, and I'm very fortunate that John and I have known each other now. Let's see, 45 years.
John is 90 years old.
That's right.
But what a talent he has been. How'd you first meet John Williams?
I was playing violin in the studios, which I did for about 8 years, 8 or 9 years. And studio instrumentalist, you get a call and they say, okay, you have a 12 to 3 session over at Fox on Wednesday with so-and-so. So I got a call, and it was for several days of work on a film with John Williams, and it was the film Jaws. And so that was 1975, and I was extremely young at the time, and the idea that I was playing in the studios was, I was having so much fun doing that, among other things. And I really had an extraordinary opportunity to work on that film. And then I also played on Close Encounters of the Third Kind and a few other of the other films that he did.
Yeah.
So, I really had a great time.
Last year, Richard, you had debut engagements with the New World in Florida and Fort Worth Symphonies, and a return engagement with the Iceland Symphony Orchestra. Recent highlights of yours include debuts with the New York Philharmonic, Leipzig Orchestra, Philadelphia Orchestra, Toronto Symphony Orchestra, and concerts throughout Australia, including at the Sydney Opera House. We are delighted that you're going to be able to hear the maestro at work. Here is Richard Kaufman directing the London Symphony Orchestra in The High and the Mighty. One of the world's leading conductors of film music, Mr. Kaufman regularly appears with the symphony orchestras of New York, San Francisco, San Diego, Atlanta, St. Louis, Cleveland, and Indianapolis in this country, and the Royal Scottish National Orchestra, London, Dublin, and Liverpool as abroad. He's also been engaged to conduct such legendary film titles as Star Wars, Jurassic Park, Jaws, The Wizard of Oz, E.T., and Raiders of the Lost Ark. As a unique part of his career, Richard has coached various actors in musical roles, including Tom Hanks, Susan Sarandon, and Dudley Moore. Richard, you were once hired to coach a 3-time Academy Award winner, Jack Nicholson, in a movie. Was that Witches of Eastwick?
Yes, it sure was.
Tell us about that.
Well, Witches of Eastwick, if people saw it, would remember Jack Nicholson is cast as the devil, and he comes to a small New England fishing village, and he immediately pursues 3 beautiful women. And one of them is a school teacher named Susan, who was played by Susan Sarandon. And she's a cellist, but she's very meek. And Jack, his character, is trying to entice her to passion. And so in doing that, he has to look like he can play the violin and has to play a short piece. And a Paganini Caprice, which in reality is a very difficult piece to play. They are difficult pieces. And he also has to look like he can play the piano when he accompanies Susan playing the Dvorak cello concerto. And so my job was to work with Jack, which I did for 3 months every day.
Wow.
Here at his house, and then go on location and help him look like he's been playing the violin his whole life. And we did, and we had a great time. He's an amazing, amazing man. His dedication to perfection is extraordinary. He wanted to look really, really good as a violinist and pianist. And so much so that when we got back to Los Angeles, we were on location working, and we came back to Los Angeles to finish shooting the film, which would include the music sequences. And George Miller was the director, and Jack came to me one morning when we were going to shoot the piano sequences. And he said, Jack said, George says he's going to want to do close-ups of my hands. He said, can you play that piano part? I said, well, yeah, why? He said, well, you do the close-ups. I said, Jack, you can do that. You know, they'll shoot your hands on the key. He says, nah, you do it. And when Jack said you do it, you do it. And so they shaved my arms up to my elbow, and they put me in his wardrobe. And so in Witches of Eastwick, this is a real Hollywood story, true story. In Witches of Eastwick, when you see them cutting to Jack's hands,
they're yours.
They're my hands. Yeah. But it was wonderful. And we were together. We didn't always work. Sometimes we would just eat and have dinner. Talked a lot of basketball.
Yeah.
Of course, he loves basketball and the Lakers and all that. But it was a great experience working with someone who is a true artist. Nice, nice man.
Well, in addition to traditional concert presentations, you also often conduct what I would say would be complete film scores in concert, where you synchronize the music. The film is shown above the orchestra. And I think you do that as well as anybody, and may have been one of the first to do it. You also conduct the scores for various silent films, and that's been very effective as well. Richard received a Grammy Award in the category of Best Pop Instrumental Performance. And he has recorded with the London Symphony, Nuremberg Symphony, also the New Zealand Symphony, the Brandenburg Philharmonic Orchestra in Berlin. He's also conducted for numerous performers, including John Denver for about 25 years, Andy Williams, Amy Grant, the Beach Boys, and many others. But as a studio violinist, Richard performed numerous film and television scores, including Jaws, Close Encounters of the Third Kind, and, as you said, in a moment of desperation, Animal House.
Animal House, Elmer Bernstein, great score, crazy film.
And he's recorded and performed in concert with artists including Frank Sinatra, Burt Bacharach, The Carpenters, and Ray Charles. Many years ago, Richard served as a music associate at 20th Century Fox before he joined the music department of Metro-Goldwyn-Mayer Studios as music coordinator. And for 18 years, he supervised music at MGM, during which he received 2 Emmy Award nominations. How did those years in the studio help you as you proceeded into being a conductor?
Wow. those years had so much effect on my work as a person, the knowledge that I had in music, in film music. I had amazing people to work for. I assisted Lionel Newman at 20th Century Fox. Lionel Newman, brother of Alfred Newman, the great film composer, and learned a tremendous amount there. And then I went over to MGM, and I was hired by a man named Harry Loyevsky. Harry Loyevsky, among other things, was Fred Astaire's rehearsal pianist. And Harry had been in the business and at MGM for decades. He became a true mentor. I would hang on every word. I would go to lunch with him and sit with him and his buddies who had been at the studio for a long time. And I, you know, would hear stories and all sorts of things. And Harry, I could go on and on about Harry Loyevsky. He was just a remarkable person. And he was an encyclopedia of music for film and television. Lionel was amazing. Learned a tremendous amount at Fox for the 2.5 years I was there. And as far as it helping my conducting, it's very interesting. A lot of symphony conductors, you know, tend to sort of dance on the podium and they're doing all sorts of things. But in film, when you're on the scoring stage, clarity is the key word. The orchestra, you don't have time for, do all sorts of other stuff. You need to be clear. That's what the musicians want. They make the music for the most part. And for the entire part, nobody's ever heard a conductor before. So the conductor's job is to lead them in the right direction and they take it from there. Being a studio violinist, the studio musicians many, many times will save the composer who's trying to conduct from embarrassment and make his or her music even better than it, you know, that it would be with them conducting. It taught me clarity. It taught me time management in rehearsals, preparation. There is no room for not being prepared. It taught me to be on time. What did Vince Lombardi say? If you get to a practice session a half hour before the session starts, you're late or something like that. And I learned the work habits, work ethics that go along with the job. And it's a privilege to be working and being paid for what you love to do. And I've never taken it for granted for one second. And so all of those lessons that I learned, whether it's the conducting or just how to work in the business, how to manage a budget, how to deal with people. Conducting, you know, it's much more than just waving your arms. People have asked me, what does a conductor do? And, you know, you're a diplomat, you're a school teacher, you know, you're a psychologist, you're a minister, you do all sorts of things on the job. And so I learned a tremendous amount about that.
Is it fair to ask if you have a favorite musical piece to play?
You can ask. If I ask you which one of your children is your favorite child.
Yes.
You know, there's a song from the musical Finian's Rainbow. When I'm not near the girl I love the girl I'm near. Well, it isn't often that I'm working on music that I just don't like. I mean, it may not be my favorite piece. I may see things that could be better, whatever. But the challenge is, if it's music that maybe needs help or needs, you know, the orchestra to make it better or whatever it is, I love the challenge. And I do have favorite pieces. I mean, I guess my favorite film composer, to say one would be, you know, impossible, but I could list a few, you know, John Williams, Elmer Bernstein, Victor Young, one of the great, great film composers. And the list goes on and on. And we live in a world of favorites, you know, everybody's voting for number one. You have all these shows that are, a panel is voting, who's the best dancer, who's the best singer, you know. Yeah. So I tend to steer away from that game, you know, when it comes to, you know, what's number one, who's your favorite, who's the top of the list, you know?
Yeah. Which symphony or symphonies that you conduct have a special place in your heart?
Well, I've been with Pacific Symphony in Orange County. Now, this is starting my 32nd year, and I've had so many wonderful experiences there working with different singers and performers and the musicians of the orchestra. I'm always kind of honored and a little bewildered when the phone rings, somebody says, will you come conduct? Because they're really giving you a major responsibility and they feel you can do the job. And so I'm you know, really humbled when I am able to do that. So when you're called by New York Philharmonic or Chicago Symphony, I've been with Chicago now in my 18th season, I pinch myself. You know, I literally stand off stage before I go on stage and I look around and I think, you know, how did this happen?
Yeah.
And but yeah, I love working with the Royal Scottish National Orchestra, the National Symphony Orchestra of Ireland in Dublin. Such nice people, and orchestras here. I mean, I could go on and on. One of the great things is to make friends of the musicians and not just to go and conduct, you know, them and work with them. Cleveland Orchestra over the last 11, 12 years. I just have such a great time. And there's a wonderful group of Christian guys who are in the orchestra. And when I got there shortly after, I guess they knew that the center of my life is my faith. And they said, you know, we have a group of guys who have breakfast. You want to come out with us? So I've had oftentimes I'll go and meet with them, and, you know, and it's just, it's wonderful because you get to know them as people, and, you know, there's so much going on, not just the playing the instrument.
Richard Kaufman's our guest. How much in advance do you schedule an appearance with the symphony? And do you have a manager who books those dates for you?
I have a wonderful manager, agent, whatever, with the company called Opus 3 Artists. His name is Matthew Oberstein, and we're friends as well as colleagues. And so Matthew is on the phone asking orchestras, you know, what's going on, or he'll get a call from an orchestra. So, yeah, that's, you know, I just basically wait for Matthew to say, this orchestra would like you to come and work with them. And he works out all the details. Symphony World schedules way ahead of time. I can tell you right now that I will be conducting the Fort Worth Symphony a year from next March. So in March of 2024,
oh my God,
March, in the middle of March, I'll be with them. And it's usually a year out,
yeah,
as they plan their schedules.
Yeah.
And it's not uncommon. They have to do that because there's so much that goes ahead of that.
Do you get the same fee wherever it is?
You mean I'm supposed to get paid for this? I do not get the same fee, and money has never been the priority, and it never will be.
Good.
I love conducting, and I love music, and money's important. A job is a job, and, you know, my beautiful wife, Gail, wants to wear clothes and eat food, and we like living in a house, but I know, I mean, I've told Matthew, I said, money will never be the priority. Let's talk about the opportunity to make the music, and then we'll see, you know.
Over the years, how much music from Broadway shows have you played?
Gosh, at one time when I was in college, all I wanted to do was conduct on Broadway. I just wanted to do musicals. That was it. And fortunately, I actually started playing in the studios my last year of college. I went to Cal State Northridge when it was San Fernando Valley State College. And I was playing the studios, and I have to go back a tiny bit. when I was in college, I just would do anything to do music, and especially Broadway and all that. And there was a community center in the Valley, San Fernando Valley, that advertised on the bulletin board. They needed a conductor for a musical, a fundraising musical called The Bells Are Ringing. The song The Party's Over is from that show and all that. And so I volunteered and I did it. And the people doing the show were, you know, like housewives and, you know, their husbands and all that. They were volunteering their time to do this musical. And to them, it was, you know, we'll go and we'll do the musical, we'll have a good time and all that. Well, to me, this was Broadway. You know, this had to be done right. And so the first rehearsal, I said, first of all, next time you're here, you need to memorize your music and the lyrics. You need to be on time. And I laid the law down. I was very strict about it because I wanted this to be great.
Right.
And so the following week or a couple of weeks later, I guess, this man shows up at the rehearsal and he comes over to me and he says, you're the conductor, right? You're Richard. I said, yes. He says, well, my wife is in the show. And she said, I should come and meet you. He said, do you play an instrument? I said, well, I'm a violinist. He said, did you ever think about playing in the studios? And I said, well, not really, but that would be great. He said, well, I want you to call me. So I called him and his name was Sid Feller. And Sid Feller was Ray Charles' arranger.
Oh.
And I found myself in college, starting to work in the studios, playing on Ray Charles' recordings. And Sid would recommend me to other people. And he recommended me to the man who was hiring the musicians for the Grammy Awards, playing the orchestra.
Ooh.
And I got hired. And I played in the orchestra, and I was such a fan of these people who were appearing on the Grammys, Henry Mancini, Sergio Mendez, and Burt Bacharach. And Burt had just won the Oscar for Raindrops and Butch Cassidy. He had won some Grammy Awards. I mean, they're coming out of his ears. And he had done a musical called Promises, Promises. And it had won the Tony Award on Broadway for Best Musical. And it was about to come to Los Angeles and play at the Amundsen Theater for 4 months. Ooh. And I went up to Burt Bacharach. And just to say, Mr. Bacharach, I just want you to know how much I love the musical Promises, Promises, because I listened to the recording over and over and over. And he said, oh, would you like to do it? And I thought he was saying, when the musical is released to be done at colleges to do it. I said, oh, that would be great. He said, well, give me your number. I gave him my phone number. Well, I was hired. And 2 days after I finished college, I was at the Amundsen playing in the orchestra.
Oh, my God.
And the assistant conductor, incredible pianist named Bill Mays, legendary, got up to conduct one night when the exit music, when people were leaving the theater, and he finished and he walked off the podium, walked through right by us. And he said, I'll never do that again. He hated conducting. So I went up to the conductor's dressing room after the show. And I said, I don't think Bill wants to conduct. I'd like to do it. So he hired me and I became the assistant conductor. And through a series of recommendations, Burt recommended me to a man named Jonathan Tunick, who was Stephen Sondheim's orchestrator. And I got a call to go and do the first national tour of Company, Steve Sondheim's show. And I did that for 8 months. And then they recommended me and I did a musical called Two Gentlemen of Verona for Joseph Papp at the New York Shakespeare Festival. And I was on the road for 9 months. So I was doing theater and I was, you know, musicals, the top of the, you know, I mean, it was just the best shows, having a great time. And, but all this time I was writing letters to the great Edwin Lester, who founded the Los Angeles Civic Light Opera. And Mr. Lester, this was in the 30s, he came to LA, I think it was, whatever. And he produced the original Kismet, Peter Pan, Song of Norway. I mean, this is one of the great, great Broadway producers. And I kept writing to him saying, "Dear Mr. Lester, if you ever need a conductor for, you know, one of the great Rodgers and Hammerstein musicals, that's what I really want to be doing," because he thought of me, I was told, as that rock and roll conductor, because I did Promises, Promises. I did Two Gentlemen of Verona, which is kind of a rock musical by Galt McDermott, who wrote the music for Hair, the musical. And so Mr. Lester thought of me as this, you know, guy who just did rock and roll. And I kept writing letters. And after about 4 or 5 years, I get a call. "Mr. Lester would like to see you." And I went down, and he hired me to do a musical called Wonderful Town by Leonard Bernstein. And that began 5 or 6 years of conducting legit musicals at the LA Civic Light Opera. So in answer to your question, I always wanted to do musicals, and I had the opportunity to do that. While I was doing that, I was playing in the studios and playing violin, and I did a lot of work at MGM. So I talked to Harry Loyevsky, who was supervising the music at MGM. I would talk to him about MGM musicals, and I couldn't get enough of the stories and all this sort of thing. And Harry called and hired me to supervise a film all about summer stock musicals, which I did. And, you know, all of that led to Lionel Newman hiring me at Fox. And then, so I transitioned into film and television. And, but I had done a lot of, in the 70s, a lot of musicals, and I loved doing it.
In your opinion, which Broadway show do you think produced the best music?
The Music Man. Without a question. It's my favorite show. I have a great personal connection to it. You know, another story. Tell me when you're sick of stories.
Tell this, because this is the film that starred Robert Preston.
Robert Preston, Shirley Jones, great musical. Meredith Willson. On Broadway, it won Best Musical, beating West Side Story. So there was something to it. And West Side Story is one of the greatest musicals of all time. Anyway, I was in junior high school, and the word went out to all the junior high schools from Warner Brothers Studios that the Warner Brothers was going to do the film version of The Music Man, and asking the orchestra band teachers to send their best brass players, woodwind players, and percussionists, drummers, to audition. Well, I was a violinist, but I just couldn't. I wanted to be in the movie. My gosh. So I went to Wallace Umber at Emerson Junior High School, the most wonderful teacher. And I said to him, I want to audition for the movie. So I need to learn a brass instrument by this weekend when the auditions are. And he said, "Well, there's no way you can learn an instrument in that amount of time." And I said, "No, you don't have to play it. The studio orchestra plays the music. I just have to learn how to hold it." So he gave me a trombone. I went to Warner Brothers, and I had red hair, bright red hair. Well, let me put it this way. I had hair. And I went and marched, and I was a great marcher. Brilliant. I was surrounded by a couple of hundred of the finest, you know, junior high school musicians in Los Angeles who could all play. I couldn't play a note, but I could march, you know. And I was chosen to be in Harold Hill's boys band in the movie The Music Man.
And you were in the front row.
Second row.
Oh.
The front row were professional dancers.
Oh.
Because the band had to be led, and they needed people who knew, you know, what they were doing. So I was in the second row. You can't really see.
Can you show people the film just to say, "There I am"?
I do. And the reason is that when we were about to shoot it, my father said, "You need to figure out something to do so that people will know you from all the other people in the band." And so as the band is marching towards the camera, and the camera is on a boom that goes up like this in the last scene, I'm on the outside in the second row. I started to move my head like this. Yes. And it's, I mean, this is so pathetic. And that's how you can actually pick. You can't see my face or anything, but
draw attention.
Yes, you could attention to it. And my father was very pleased. And I love the movie. I mean, it was truly a fabulous movie. And we didn't plan this, but this was taken on the set of out at Warner Brothers between filming. And that's somebody who had no business holding a trombone because he couldn't play it.
Oh, wow. Were you 13?
I was 13 years old.
Oh.
So well, there you go.
A mutual friend of both of ours loved Broadway music.
Yeah.
And played that kind of music in his car many nights on the way to work at Dodger Stadium. And his name was?
The great Vin Scully.
You developed quite a friendship with him, and you discussed that a lot, didn't you?
Well, that's because of you, Ross. At the golf tournament, he would come for lunch. I mean, you and he were such great friends, and he loved and respected you so much. And so he would go out of his way to be sure he was at the golf tournament every year, either at the dinner or he would come for lunch. I mean, it was amazing. And everybody loved him. And there he was. And I knew that he loved the music from The Music Man. I don't know if I heard him say it or somebody say it, and that he played musicals driving back and forth to Dodger Stadium. So I went up to him and I said, I just want to tell you, we have something in common. And I told him, and his face lit up and we became instant, you know, we bonded because of The Music Man. And we ended up, we had lunch a couple of times, and at the first time we had lunch, he showed up at the restaurant and sat down and he handed me a piece of paper. And he said, I want you to tell me about this. And he had on the internet printed out the description of a baton. Mm. A conductor, you know, uses. Yeah. He said, what is the baton for? He was so interested in the baton. And so I told him, I said, well, you can use it this way, sometimes some conductors use it, they don't. It was fascinating. And during the conversation, it came up that I was about to go over to Ireland and conduct there. And he told me that a cousin of his was in politics there and was like Lord Mayor of Dublin or whatever it was. And told me her name and all that. So when I was about to go, I looked her up and somehow I found a phone number and an email. And I emailed her. I said, I told her that I knew Vin and all that. And I went over, did the show. I invited her to the concert. She came. She invited me to her house. I went to her house for dinner with a lot of her friends. And we have become friends over the years now, the last, I don't know, 6, 7, 8 years. And every time I go there, Mary Freehill, she comes to the concert, we go have dinner, we have lunch. And every time I would go there, I would videotape a message from her to Vin.
Oh.
And I would send it on to him.
That's wonderful. And,
so yeah, Vin, I mean, the opportunity to know Vin, I mean, you and Vin were the voice of you know, my youth in a lot of ways. Vin a lot earlier because he and Jerry Doggett, you know, when they first came to L.A.
32 years, Vin and Jerry. 28 years, Vin and me.
Amazing. And I had met Vin Scully when I was 10, I was 11 years old. My family would always go out to, I don't know if I've ever told you this, my family and I would go out to dinner with my grandparents every Sunday. And we went to a restaurant in Santa Monica one Sunday in 1958.
Yeah, first year they were here.
Yeah. And it was a restaurant called Fox and Hounds on Wilshire Boulevard. Wonderful restaurant, white tablecloths. And I remember that. And we sat down and I looked And over in the other side of the restaurant was Vin Scully talking with somebody, sitting, you know, talking. And my father, I said, it's Vin Scully. My father said, you have to go say hello. My father always was telling me, go say hello to so-and-so, go say. So I got up and I went over and said, you know, Mr. Scully, I just want to tell you how much I love you, you know, and all this. So I met Vin when I was, you know, and he, I remember what we said, what he said, but I remember going back and feeling great. It wasn't like, get out of here, kid, I'm busy.
Yeah.
You know.
You know, and what I've said about him and 28 years working with him in every situation, I never saw Vin Scully rude to one person.
Ross, you and Vin are cut from the same cloth. I mean, I remember listening to Dodger talk after the games, and you would be talking with people, and people would call in. They were nervous. They might have a gripe about something that happened, whatever. But you always, 100%, were kind. And you and Vin, it was the same thing. I think the only difference is he had red hair. You know, you had the same birthday. I mean, you know.
That's right, we did. Oh, while you're bringing that up, I would invite you to come up and see me in the booth after games while I was doing Dodger Talk, which I did for 14 years. Tell everybody what happened that night when you came up in the booth in San Francisco.
Thank you, Ross, for bringing this up. Went up there, I was... you were about to, the game had ended, and Gail and Lynn, our wives, had gone back to the hotel, and I came up to the booth, and I was sitting next to you, and you gave me a headset so I could hear the back and forth, and there were volume dials on a little box, two or three, four, you know, things, and he said, if you need it louder, you can do that or do this, you know, and so you're on the air, and you're, you know, you're talking, and all this, and I was adjusting my volume. I went, oh, like this. And all of a sudden, your eyes got like this. And you went like this. And you went, boom, and you reached over. And I had turned you off. I had literally turned Ross Porter on the Dodger Talk.
Oh, that's funny.
I apologize again, Ross.
Another one of your funny stories took place in Bulgaria.
Oh, yeah. I've been so fortunate to travel and conduct in different countries. And that's one of the joys about conducting. You're working with musicians and you're meeting so many other people of different walks of life, and especially other parts of the world. And so I was hired to conduct the Bulgarian Philharmonic. And I went over there, and most of the orchestra did not really speak English. We got by and all, and there was a translator if I needed it. And the orchestra, very nice people, but they were during the rehearsal, they were kind of talking and, you know, whispering and all this sort of thing. And I saw a couple of cell phones. And so I stopped and I said, I really need to ask. And I never single anybody out in a rehearsal. I'll talk to a whole section of musicians, but and there's never anger, it doesn't do any good. So I told them, I said, please, we have a lot of work to do, and I know everybody wants everything to go really well, so let's, you know, maybe not talk quite so much unless it's about the music, and please, no cell phones. So later on in the rehearsal, we were about to play music by Elmer Bernstein from To Kill a Mockingbird. And so I announced, I said, all right, let's play the music from To Kill a Mockingbird. And I turn the pages in my score and I'm ready and I go like this. And in the back of the violin section is a young guy whose violin is in his lap and he's on his cell phone like this. I could feel my temperature go up. I thought, oh man. So I turned to the violin section and I said to them and everyone over here, please, as I mentioned before, please no cell phones. Let's just stay right here and focus on what we're doing. So we played, and then we played it. And then on the break, right afterwards, I walked off the podium and this young man comes running up to me. And he said, Maestro, Maestro, Maestro. He said, I want you to know, I was not talking on the cell phone and I wasn't doing anything, you know, that you didn't want us to do. I said, nobody in the violin section knows what a mockingbird is, and I was looking it up on the internet.
That's great.
I said, that's okay.
Well, folks, let's be treated again to another sample of Richard Kaufman's musical talent. This time he's directing the Nuremberg Symphony, and the song is Magnificent Seven. Richard loves lemon meringue pie. I told him if he could answer any of these questions today, I would personally buy him a lemon meringue pie. So here we go.
I'm ready, Ross.
I know you'll be honest.
No, for a lemon meringue pie, I will lie my head off.
Have you kept track of the number of concerts you have conducted? How many different symphonies and orchestras have you worked with? And in how many foreign countries have you performed?
Wow. No to the first one, because I've been doing this. I mean, I started conducting, if you're talking about any time I walked on a podium for Broadway or symphony or anything, I mean, I've been doing this now 52 years.
Oh.
And there are times in some years I would be doing 80 concerts a year. So I really can't tell you how many I've done. As far as the number of symphonies I've conducted, a lot of them, and not all major symphonies. I mean, I've been so blessed to work with New York Philharmonic and Philadelphia Orchestra, Cleveland, Chicago, the Boston Pops, Atlanta, Dallas, Houston. I mean, it goes on and on and on. So a lot of orchestras. And as far as the number of countries I've conducted in, which would be easier, I mean, I will just say that I've conducted on the other side of the Atlantic and on the other side of the Pacific. And north of the United States and South America. And, you know, so, you know, when the phone rings, I go.
Would you settle for coconut pie?
Sure. Absolutely. Absolutely. I see, you know me, I'll eat anything. It's sad.
I want to go way back.
Okay.
When you're growing up, you love baseball, you still do. And Richard is so excited about baseball. He spent a great deal of time recently looking at the Little League World Series and got very, very excited about it, didn't you?
Yeah, it's great. Little League World Series is fantastic.
But anyway, talk about the early days. Another actor was your coach one time. Was that Little League that you were playing?
I played Little League baseball in West Los Angeles. And it was sort of known for having kids whose parents were in the business in various areas. One of the men who was a coach, he was the construction, he was head of construction of all the sets for the film Cleopatra, as an example. Mm-hmm. Lauren Bacall was out there with her son. Mm-hmm. Phil Silvers would come out and sometimes would umpire, if you can imagine that.
And the head coach was, and he won one Oscar.
Well, that was not in Little League. I played Little League, and then I went on to Pony League,
okay,
which was, you know, right after that. I think I was 13 or 12, whatever it was. And our team was the Dodgers. And one of our coaches was a man named Alan Woods, who was a writer. He wrote episodes of Lassie, Superman, you know, great sitcoms of the 50s. And our coach, his son was on the team, and his son's name was Bill Lancaster. And Bill Lancaster was a wonderful catcher. And his father was Burt Lancaster, a wonderful actor.
Elmer Gantry.
Elmer, well, yeah, among so many, so many films. I mean, you know, he was Elmer Gantry. I mean, the list goes on and on and on. But he was, when he was out there coaching us, he was a dad.
Yeah.
And, you know, he was a, he was the dad with the Oscars.
And didn't Bill Lancaster do something later that...
He did, but I, if you'd like, I have a picture if you want to see.
Please do. Yeah, show us.
So this is our team, and I'll hold it up, and I'll try to make it as clear as possible. And if you look down in right, let's see, I get my finger right. Well, I'll do it here. Ah, there we, we're still there. So yeah. That is me on the end in the bottom row. And next to me is Bill Lancaster.
Okay.
And then we go down here, and if you look in the back row, the tall gentleman with the glasses, you can see, I don't know how clear that is. Hopefully yeah. There is Burt Lancaster.
Probably. What position did you play?
Well, I started playing catcher, but my father very quickly realized that he was spending a ton of money on violin lessons. And he made the decision that there's no way I was going to catch with my fingers, you know, in jeopardy. So they put me in the outfield, and I was basically the worst outfielder you could ever imagine. But we had Bill Lancaster was heroic. Bill had polio when he was little. Mm. And he dealt with that. And he then, he was our catcher, and he was a great hitter. But it would take him a long time to get to first base. But he never gave up. I mean, he was amazing. So Burt was our coach. Our rivals were the Yankees.
Oh, yeah.
And their manager, their head coach, was a wonderful actor named Richard Jekyll, Dick Jekyll.
Oh, sure.
And who people might remember from the Dirty Dozen. He played the sergeant to Lee Marvin and all of that. But we had a great time. So I'll tell you a story about Billy Lancaster. When I was later on, I was playing violin in the studios. And when you went to a session, they wouldn't tell you what the film was necessarily. You go in and the screen was up on the wall, a regular size motion picture screen. So it was huge. And you'd be playing and kind of glancing up and seeing what the scene was. And it was all about Little League Baseball. And I turned to my stand partner in the violin section and I said, "Looks, this film looks like it's about Little League Baseball." And they said, "Yeah." And they said, "You know who wrote it?" I said, "No, who?" He said, "Billy Lancaster, Burt Lancaster's son." And I remember turning and saying, "You've got to be kidding." Well, the film Bill wrote was The Bad News Bears.
Oh.
And it was loosely based, and I mean loosely based, on our team. We had no girls on the team. Uh-huh. Coaches didn't drink beer in the dugout. The Vic Morrow character on the other team, who was really, you know, this really mean, tough guy, Dick Jekyll, was not nowhere near like that. And but that's, it was about our team. And if you, today, if you go to the corner of Sepulveda and Ohio Avenue and Sepulveda Boulevard, the fields are still there. They use them. And there's a big sign that says Bad News Bears Field.
Wow.
So I was on the Bad News Bears. We weren't bad, though.
You received the Distinguished Alumni Award from what they like to call CISA now. They don't want you to use Cal State Northridge.
Right.
But that's a great honor. Tell everybody, though, what happened when you were still a student there. I think he went over, didn't he, one day to the student union, and there were a bunch of football players over there.
Oh,
and well, they saw you coming.
We were living in the dorm. There was the dorm across the street from the university, and we would always be together. I mean, I was part of the marching band. I would write some of the shows for the halftime, and then every so often I would march in the band. You know, by that time I could play the trombone badly. It's not that I didn't play it at all. Now I played it badly. And we would sit around and eat dinner and all this sort of thing. And one day, and the school was only 7 years old, you know, the college. If it was San Fernando Valley State College. And so one of the football players said, you know, we've got a music department. You think they could write one lousy alma mater? Because we had no alma mater. We had no fight song. And I was motivated through anger and being insulted. And I got up and went back to my dorm room, and I had a little electric piano, and I wrote something of this. And I came back, I don't know, about a half hour later, and I said, here's your alma mater. And I had somebody sing it. we went to a classroom or something. A guy named Mike Reisig, he was a wonderful tenor. I said, could you sing this, please? And I had a piano player, because I don't play piano, play it. And it evolved. They said, this is good. And it went to the student senate. They heard it and they voted it. And so it became the alma mater, which it is to this day. For Cal State Northridge. And then at one point they needed a fight song, and somebody had the idea, well, why don't we just play the alma mater faster? And they did. And it's the fight song also.
You know, I want to talk now about your family, because there's some musical talent there. Let's begin with your lovely wife, Gail.
Yep. Gail's a dancer. She was a professional dancer for many years. Her career was extraordinary. She did a lot of television, a lot of film. She was on the Academy Awards 6 times dancing. She co-starred with Liza Minnelli in a Broadway show for a year called The Act. She danced with, it goes on and on. She was on a wonderful show called Solid Gold, which was the hits of the day, rock and roll hits of the day. And she, you know, danced on that show for a long time.
And she was with Ann Margaret on, was it Elvis?
No, she was with Ann Margaret in Las Vegas. Okay. Ann Margaret did a big show at the Hilton, and Gail was one of the dancers. And she just danced on television specials, Sonny and Cher, with Steve Martin. I mean, just George Burns, she danced on his special. And so, yeah, Gail had a tremendous career.
And your daughter, Whitney, a graduate of Chapman down in Orange County.
Yep.
Has carried on beautifully. And you're so proud of her. Tell the folks about her accomplishments.
Well, this chat just got about another 2 hours long. So here we go. No, I'm kidding. Whitney graduated Chapman with honors, a terrific student, and she has a wonderful voice, and she's a wonderful actor, and she has been doing musicals and voiceover work and television for a number of years now. She was in the national tour of the musical Mamma Mia, and often did the lead. She was at the Pantages Theater. She was, you know, in Boston, all over the place. And now she sings symphony concerts with symphony orchestras all over the world. She's about to leave next week for South Korea for her 8th time there.
Wow.
She just got back from Taiwan last week. She has sung, you name it. She's been there, and she's terrific. But most importantly, as the music director for Mamma Mia told me when I was visiting the show one time, she said, Whitney is a bright light backstage. Everybody loves her, and she just inspires people. So that to me is more important than any note she would ever sing.
That's right. And she has appeared with you at your concerts.
Yeah, every so often I'll have the opportunity, if I need a singer, to ask Whitney to come and sing. So we've done concerts, with the Dallas Symphony, Florida Orchestra, with the Malaysian Philharmonic in Kuala Lumpur, with Pacific Symphony, you know, some different orchestras. We have a great time.
One of your best friends is a fellow who's been a very popular television personality. He's been the host of a great TV show for 41 years. Tell us who that was and what the show was.
Well, Pat Sajak, on Wheel of Fortune, obviously. I met Pat through friends of mine. I had done a musical with them on the road, and they lived in Nashville. And this is back in 77. I had known them before that. We'd done the musical 4 or 5 years before that. So in 77, they said, we have a friend who's coming out to Los Angeles to do the weather on Channel 4 on NBC. We don't think he knows many people. Why don't you go say hello? So I went, I was working at NBC one day. I went down into the basement. There was Pat in his office, and I went in and introduced myself, and we became friends over the years. Very, very, very close friends. I'm happy to say. Racquetball, you know, playing, you know, we've had a lot of wonderful adventures. And so Pat and I became friends. And I mean, to this day, you know.
Well, Pat loves hockey. And he called you one time at home and said, hey, the playoffs are underway. Let's go out to the Forum in Inglewood to see this game tonight. So out you go. And it looked like it was going to be a runaway, didn't it?
It was. The other team was up by 4 or 5 goals.
5-0.
Sorry?
5-0.
Yeah. And so Pat had worked earlier in the day, and I had worked her. And so... and he was doing Wheel by that time. And so we just said, you know, this is a lost cause, and went home. And by the time we got home, the Kings were catching up, caught up, and won the game. And I called him and basically said, if you tell anybody we left that game, I will never forget you.
And it was known as the Miracle on Manchester.
On Manchester.
The Forum was on Manchester Boulevard.
Yeah.
It happened.
Yeah. And we would go to Dodger games a lot. My dad would share season tickets with a gentleman. And so I would finish at MGM and Pat would finish working. And we'd go to the game and sit, you know, up in the orange seats, the second level. And after the game was over, we'd sit there. The place would empty out. We'd talk and all that. So, yeah, great, great times, great sports. So, one time, Pat, he was a Cubs fan. He's from Chicago.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
And so during spring training, Pat said, I worked it out that I've got them to send me down with a camera guy to the Cubs spring training to do some sort of a report. And it was all just, you know, to get down to spring training. So we went down to spring.
That's great. Richard, what a fabulous life. We so much enjoyed being able to talk to you about it today. Thank you.
Russ, thank you. When you told me you wanted to talk to me, the first thing I thought about was, okay, here's a man who has interviewed thousands of people. Not 100, but thousands of people. And the idea that I get to be one of those was it's really an honor. I mean, we're close friends and all that, but it really means a lot that, you know, you'd want to do that. So thank you. And again, I just cherish our friendship, and, you know, I hope you go on doing this for many, 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 many years.
Richard, God bless. Stay healthy. And I know you're about ready to leave again on another trip. So safe travels.
Thanks, Ross.